This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book Reflections, or Sentences and Moral Maxims. Author, François duc de la Rochefoucauld. Translator's Introduction. The description of the ancient regime in France, a despotism tempered by epigrams, like most epigrammatic sentences, contains some truth, with much fiction. The society of the last half of the 17th, and the whole of the 18th centuries, was doubtless greatly influenced by the precise and terse mode in which the popular writers of that date expressed their thoughts. To a people naturally inclined to think that every possible view, every conceivable argument, upon a question is included in a short aphorism, a shrug, and the word, voila, truths expressed in condensed sentences must always have a peculiar charm. It is, perhaps, from this love of epigram that we find so many eminent French writers of maxims. Pascal, de Retz, La Rochefoucauld, La Bruyère, Montesquieu, and Vauvenargues each contributed to the rich stock of French epigrams. No other country can show such a list of brilliant writers. In England, certainly we cannot. Our most celebrated, Lord Bacon, has, by his other works, so surpassed his maxims that their fame is, to a great measure, obscured. The only Englishman who could have rivaled La Rochefoucauld or La Bruyère was the Earl of Chesterfield, and he only could have done so from his very intimate connection with France, but unfortunately his brilliant genius was spent in the impossible task of trying to refine a boorish young Briton in cutting blocks with a razor. Of all the French epigrammatic writers, La Rochefoucauld is at once the most widely known and the most distinguished. Voltaire, whose opinion on the century of Louis XIV is entitled to the greatest weight, says, "One of the works that most largely contributed to form the taste of the nation and to diffuse a spirit of justice and precision is the collection of maxims by François duc de la Rochefoucauld." This François, the second duc de la Rochefoucauld, Prince de Marsillac, the author of the maxims, was one of the most illustrious members of the most illustrious families among the French noblesse. Descended from the ancient Dukes of Guienne, the founder of the family Foulque or Foucault, a younger branch of the House of Lusignan, was at the commencement of the 11th century the seigneur of a small town, La Roche, in the Angoumois. Our chief knowledge of this feudal lord is drawn from the monkish chronicles. As the benefactor of the various abbeys and monasteries in his province, he is naturally spoken of by them in terms of eulogy. And in the charter of one of the abbeys of Angoulême he is called Vir Nobilissimus Fulcaldus. His territorial power enabled him to adopt what was then, as is still in Scotland, a common custom, to prefix the name of his estate to his surname, and thus to create and transmit to his descendants the illustrious surname of La Rochefoucauld. From that time until that great crisis in the history of the French aristocracy, the Revolution of 1789, the family of La Rochefoucauld have been, if not first, in the very first line of that most illustrious body. One seigneur served under Philip Augustus against Richard Coeur de Lion, and was made prisoner at the Battle of Gisors. The eighth seigneur Guy performed a great tilt at Bordeaux, attended, according to Froissart, to the lists by some 200 of his kindred and relations. The 16th seigneur Francais was chamberlain to Charles VIII and Louis XII, and stood at the font as sponsor, giving his name to that last light of French chivalry, Francis I. In 1515 he was created a baron, and was afterwards advanced to a count, on account of his great service to Francis and his predecessors. The second count pushed the family fortune still further, by obtaining a patent as the Prince de Marsillac. His widow, Anne de Polignac, entertained Charles V at the family chateau at Verteuil, in so princely a manner that on leaving Charles observed, he had never entered a house so redolent of high virtue, uprightness and lordliness as that mansion. The third count, after serving with distinction under the Duke of Guise against the Spaniards, was made prisoner at St. Quentin, and only regained his liberty to fall a victim to the bloody infamy of St. Bartholomew. His son, the fourth count, saved with difficulty from that massacre after serving with distinction in the religious wars, was taken prisoner in a skirmish at St. Eriex-la-Percha, and murdered by the Leaguers in cold blood. The fifth count, one of the ministers of Louis XIII, after fighting against the English and Buckingham at the Isle de Ré, was created a duke. His son Francis II Duke, by his writings, has made the family name a household word. The third Duke fought in many of the earlier campaigns of Louis XIV, at Torcy, Lille, Cambrai, and was dangerously wounded at the passage of the Rhine. From his bravery he rose to high favour at court, and was appointed Master of the Horse, Grand Veneur, and Lord Chamberlain. His son, the fourth Duke, commanded the regiment of Navarre, and took part in storming the village of Neerwinden on the day when William III was defeated at Landen. He was afterwards created Duke de la Rochechouart and Marquis de Liancourt. The fifth Duke, banished from court by Louis XV, became the friend of the philosopher Voltaire. The sixth Duke, the friend of Condorcet, was the last of the long line of noble lords who bore that distinguished name. In those terrible days of September 1792, when the French people were proclaiming universal humanity, the Duke was seized as an aristocrat by the mob at Gisors and put to death behind his own carriage, in which sat his mother and his wife, at the very place where, some six centuries previously, his ancestor had been taken prisoner in a fair fight. A modern writer has spoken of this murder as an admirable reprisal upon the grandson for the writings and conduct of the grandfather. But M. Sainte-Beuve observes as to this, he can see nothing admirable in the death of the Duke, and if it proves anything, it is only that the grandfather was not so wrong in his judgment of men as is usually supposed. Francis, the author, was born on the 15th of December 1615. M. Sainte-Beuve divides his life into four periods, first from his birth till he was 35, when he became mixed up in the War of the Fronde, the second period during the progress of that war, the third, the 12 years that followed, while he recovered from his wounds, and wrote his maxims during his retirement from society, and the last from that time till his death. In the same way that Herodotus calls each book of his history by the name of one of the muses, so each of these four periods of La Rochefoucauld's life may be associated with the name of a woman who was for the time his ruling passion. These four ladies are the Duchess de Chevreuse, the Duchess de Longueville, Madame de Sable, and Madame de Lafayette. La Rochefoucauld's early education was neglected. His father, occupied in the affairs of state, either had not or did not devote any time to his education. His natural talents and his habits of observation soon, however, supplied all deficiencies. By birth and station placed in the best society of the French court, he soon became a most finished courtier. Knowing how precarious court favor then was, his father, when young Rochefoucauld was only 9 years old, sent him into the army. He was subsequently attached to the regiment of Auvergne. Though but 16, he was present and took part in the military operations at the siege of Kassel. The court of Louis XIII was then ruled imperiously by Richelieu. The Duke de la Rochefoucauld was strongly opposed to the cardinal's party. By joining in the plots of Gaston of Orleans, he gave Richelieu an opportunity of ridding Paris of his opposition. When those plots were discovered, the Duke was sent into a sort of banishment to Blois. His son, who was then at court with him, was upon the pretext of a liaison with Mdlay. De Hautefort, one of the ladies-in-waiting on the Queen, Anne of Austria, but in reality to prevent the Duke learning what was passing at Paris, sent with his father. The result of the exile was Rochefoucauld's marriage. With the exception that his wife's name was Mdlay Vivonne, and that she was the mother of five sons and three daughters, nothing is known of her. While Rochefoucauld and his father were at Blois, the Duchess de Chevreuse, one of the beauties of the court and the mistress of Louis, was banished to Tours. She and Rochefoucauld met and soon became intimate, and for a time she was destined to be the one motive of his actions. The Duchess was engaged in a correspondence with the court of Spain and the Queen. Into this plot Rochefoucauld threw himself with all his energy. His connection with the Queen brought him back to his old love Mdlay de Hautefort, and led him to her party, which he afterwards followed. The course he took shut him off from all chance of court favour. The King regarded him with coldness, the Cardinal with irritation. Although the Bastille and the scaffold, the fate of Chalais and Montmorency, were before his eyes, they failed to deter him from plotting. He was about 23. Returning to Paris, he warmly sided with the Queen. He says in his memoirs that the only persons she could then trust were himself and Mdlay. de Hortefort, and it was proposed he should take both of them from Paris to Brussels. Into this plan he entered with all his youthful indiscretion, it being for several reasons the very one he would wish to adopt, as it would strengthen his influence with Anne of Austria, place Richelieu and his master in an uncomfortable position, and save M. Lay. De Hortefort from the attentions the king was showing her. But Richelieu of course discovered this plot, and Rochefoucauld was of course sent to the Bastille. He was liberated after a week's imprisonment, but banished to his chateau at Verteuil. The reason for this clemency was that the cardinal desired to win Rochefoucauld from the queen's party. A command in the army was offered to him, but by the queen's orders refused. For some 3 years Rochefoucauld remained at Verteuil, waiting the time for his reckoning with Richelieu, speculating on the king's death, and the favours he would then receive from the queen. During this period, he was more or less engaged in plotting against his enemy, the cardinal, and hatching treason with Cinq Mars and De Thou. M. Sainte-Beuve says that unless we study this first part of Rochefoucauld's life, we shall never understand his maxims. The bitter disappointment of the passionate love, the high hopes then formed, the deceit and treachery then witnessed, furnished the real key to their meaning. The cutting cynicism of the morality was built on the ruins of that chivalrous ambition and romantic affection. He saw his friend Cinq Mars sent to the scaffold, himself betrayed by men whom he had trusted, and the only reason he could assign for these actions was intense selfishness. Meanwhile, Richelieu died. Rochefoucauld returned to court and found Anne of Austria regent and Mazarin minister. The queen's former friends flocked there in numbers, expecting that now their time of prosperity had come. They were bitterly disappointed. Mazarin relied on hope instead of gratitude to keep the queen's adherents on his side. The most that any received were promises that were never performed. In after years, doubtless, Rochefoucauld's recollection of his disappointment led him to write the maxim, "We promise according to our hopes, we perform according to our fears." But he was not even to receive promises, he asked for the governorship of Havre, which was then vacant. He was flatly refused. Disappointment gave rise to anger, and uniting with his old flame, the Duchess de Chevreuse, who had received the same treatment, and with the Duke of Beaufort, they formed a conspiracy against the government. The plot was, of course, discovered and crushed. Beaufort was arrested, the Duchess banished. Irritated and disgusted, Rochefoucauld went with the Duke d'Enghien, who was then joining the army on a campaign, and here he found the one love of his life, the Duke's sister, Mme de Longueville. This lady, young, beautiful, and accomplished, obtained a great ascendancy over Rochefoucauld, and was the cause of his taking the side of Conde in the subsequent civil war. Rochefoucauld did not stay long with the army. He was badly wounded at the siege of Mardyk, and returned from thence to Paris. On recovering from his wounds, the War of the Fronde broke out. This war is said to have been most ridiculous, as being carried on without a definite object, a plan, or a leader. But this description is hardly correct. It was the struggle of the French nobility against the rule of the court, an attempt, the final attempt, to recover their lost influence over the state, and to save themselves from sinking under the rule of cardinals and priests. With the general history of that war we have nothing to do. It is far too complicated and too confused to be stated here. The memoirs of Rochefoucauld and de Retz will give the details to those who desire to trace the contests of the factions, the course of the intrigues. We may confine ourselves to its progress, so far as it relates to the Duc de la Rochefoucauld. On the cardinal causing the Prince de Conde and Conti, and the Duc de Longueville, to be arrested, Rochefoucauld and the Duchess fled into Normandy. Leaving her at Dieppe, he went into Poitou, of which province he had some years previously bought the post of governor. He was there joined by the Duc de Bouillon, and he and the Duke marched to and occupied Bordeaux. Cardinal Mazarin and Maréchal de la Meilleraie advanced in force on Bordeaux and attacked the town. A bloody battle followed. Rochefoucauld defended the town with the greatest bravery and repulsed the cardinal. Notwithstanding the repulse, the burghers of Bordeaux were anxious to make peace and save the city from destruction. The Parliament of Bordeaux compelled Rochefoucauld to surrender. He did so, and returned nominally to Poitou, but in reality in secret to Paris. There he found the queen engaged in trying to maintain her position by playing off the rival parties of the Prince Conde and the Cardinal de Retz against each other. Rochefoucauld eagerly espoused his old party, that of Conde. In August 1651, the contending parties met in the hall of the Parliament of Paris, and it was with great difficulty they were prevented from coming to blows even there. It is even said that Rochefoucauld had ordered his followers to murder de Retz. Rochefoucauld was soon to undergo a bitter disappointment. While occupied with party strife and faction in Paris, Madame de Chevreuse left him and formed an alliance with the Duc de Nemours. Rochefoucauld still loved her. It was probably thinking of this that he afterwards wrote, "Jealousy is born with love but does not die with it." He endeavored to get Madame de Chatillon, the old mistress of the Duc de Nemours, reinstated in favor, but in this he did not succeed. The Duc de Nemours was soon after killed in a duel. The war went on, and after several indecisive skirmishes, the decisive battle was fought at Paris, in the Faubourg Street Antoine, where the Parisians first learnt the use or the abuse of their favorite defense, the barricade. In this battle, Rochefoucauld behaved with great bravery. He was wounded in the head, a wound which for a time deprived him of his sight. Before he recovered, the war was over. Louis XIV had attained his majority, the gold of Mazarin, the arms of Turenne had been successful, the French nobility were vanquished, the court supremacy established. This completed Rochefoucauld's active life. When he recovered his health, he devoted himself to society. Madame de Sable assumed a hold over him. He lived a quiet life and occupied himself in composing an account of his early life, called his Memoirs and his Immortal Maxims. From the time he ceased to take part in public life, Rochefoucauld's real glory began. Having acted the various parts of soldier, politician, and lover with but small success, he now commenced the part of moralist, by which he is known to the world. Living in the most brilliant society that France possessed, famous from his writings, distinguished from the part he had taken in public affairs, he formed the center of one of those remarkable French literary societies, a society which numbered among its members La Fontaine, Racine, Boileau. Among his most attached friends was Madame de Lafayette, the authoress of The Princess of Cleves, and this friendship continued until his death. He was not, however, destined to pass away in that gay society without some troubles. At the passage of the Rhine in 1672, two of his sons were engaged. The one was killed, the other severely wounded. Rochefoucauld was much affected by this, but perhaps still more by the death of the young Duc de Longueville, who perished on the same occasion. Saint Beuve says that the cynical book and that young life were the only fruits of the War of the Fronde. Madame de Savigne, who was with him when he heard the news of the death of so much that was dear to him, says, "I saw his heart laid bare on that cruel occasion, and his courage, his merit, his tenderness and good sense surpassed all I ever met with. I hold his wit and accomplishments as nothing in comparison." The combined effect of his wounds and the gout caused the last years of Rochefoucauld's life to be spent in great pain. Madame de Savigne, who was with him continually during his last illness, speaks of the fortitude with which he bore his sufferings as something to be admired. Writing to her daughter, she says, "Believe me, it is not for nothing he has moralized all his life. He has thought so often on his last moments that they are nothing new or unfamiliar to him." In his last illness, the great moralist was attended by the great divine, Bossuet. Whether that matchless eloquence or his own philosophic calm had, in spite of his writings, brought him into the state Madame de Savigne describes, we know not, but one, or both, contributed to his passing away in a manner that did not disgrace a French noble or a French philosopher. On the 11th of March 1680, he ended his stormy life in peace after so much strife, a loyal subject after so much treason. One of his friends, Madame de Chauliers, shortly before he died sent him an ode on death, which aptly describes his state. "We, soyez à laws plus firm, que ces vulgaires humains qui, pray de leur dernier terme, devaines terreurs sont pleins. In sage que rien in offense, livrez-vous sans resistance à d'inévitables traits, et d'un dommage égal, passez cet en fatal carne any repasse jamais." Rochefoucauld left behind him only two works, the one, Memoirs of His Own Time, the other the Maxims. The first described the scenes in which his youth had been spent, and though written in a lively style, and giving faithful pictures of the intrigues and the scandals of the court during Louis XV's minority, yet, except to the historian, has ceased at the present day to be of much interest. It forms, perhaps, the true key to understand the special, as opposed to general application of the maxims. Notwithstanding the assertion of Bayle, that there are few people so bigoted to antiquity as not to prefer the memoirs of La Rochefoucauld to the commentaries of Caesar, or the statement of Voltaire, that the memoirs are universally read and the maxims are learnt by heart. Few persons at the present day ever heard of the memoirs, and the knowledge of most as to the maxims is confined to that most celebrated of all, though omitted from his last edition. There is something in the misfortunes of our best friends which does not wholly displease us. Yet it is difficult to assign a cause for this. No book is perhaps oftener unwittingly quoted, none certainly oftener unblushingly pillaged, upon none have so many contradictory opinions been given. Few books, says Mr. Hallam, have been more highly extolled or more severely blamed than the maxims of the Duke of Rochefoucauld, and that not only here but also in France. Rousseau speaks of it as a sad and melancholy book, though he goes on to say, it is usually so in youth when we do not...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.